What would you do if I sang out of tune? Would you stand up and walk out on me? Lend me your ears and I'll sing you a song. I will try not to sing out of key. Yeah. Oh, baby, how do you I'm gonna get high.
When it comes to why Westminster hasn't been helping putting forward the arguments or the numbers for what things cost, I'm afraid that's because the Edinburgh Agreement, which Nicola signed with them, precluded any pre-negotiation. It was in there. It's absolutely to the letter of it. You can Google it tonight. You can pull it up. You can see that they agreed that they would not have any pre-negotiation ahead of a yes vote. I'm telling folk they can go and Google it. I'm not telling them what the letter of the law is. They can go away and have a look at it for themselves.
We tried Google Kezia, and guess what? We found precisely nothing. The 13 pages of the Edinburgh Agreement, which you can look at yourself here, just press the pause button, Kez, makes no mention anywhere of the term pre-negotiations. That, Kezia, is a big fat lie. But no matter, you got away with it. You got by with a little help from your friends in the BBC and the corporate press, who somewhat helpfully made no mention anywhere of your misinformation. Here we see a tweet from Kezia in response to the SNP's Natalie McGarry, now the MP for Glasgow East. Natalie points out to Kez that, contrary to their claims, the Labour Party did not abolish student tuition fees in Scotland, but in fact replaced them with a graduate endowment. As we can now plainly see, despite what Kezia claims, the graduate endowment, according to the QBE report here in The Guardian, was expressly intended as a partial repayment of fees, which at the time were £1,000 a year, or £4,000 for a standard four-year Scottish degree. Labour had introduced fees in 1998, then effectively halved, rather than abolished, them 2 years later. The endowment looked so small compared to current fees that it's easy to overlook that when it was introduced, it still amounted to backdated fees at 50% of the previous level. When Labour took power in 1997, students in Scotland had to pay nothing for a degree. 3 years later, they were paying £2,000, but Labour had somehow managed to paint that as being an abolition rather than an imposition. And then, in 2008, when the SNP brought forward a bill to end the graduate endowment and thereby genuinely abolish Labour's tuition fees, Labour and the Tories voted against it. As for slashing bursaries, it's true that they were substantially reduced in 2014 under austerity cuts. But the Scottish Government's annual investment in tuition, grants and bursaries, that's excluding loans, has risen under the SNP from £50 million a year in 2000 to over £305 million, a huge real terms increase, partly explained by the record numbers of students who went on to enrol in Scottish universities after the abolition of fees. In other words, Kezia Dugdale's comments are almost entirely at odds with the truth of the situation. But no matter, she got away with it again. She got by with a little help from her friends in the BBC and the corporate press, who, once again, made no mention anywhere of her highly misleading comments. Here we find Kez claiming on Gordon Brewer's Sunday Politics Scotland show that Stuart Hosey of the SNP hadn't said whether a commitment to a second independence referendum would be in the party's general election manifesto. Is Kez right? Let's have a listen.
Labour. But there's something else quite revealing in your programme this morning, and that was Stuart Hosey dodging and diving over the question of when the next independence referendum would be. And can I say to you, Gordon, this morning, I've had a look. in every single SNP manifesto since 1999, whether it be for the UK Parliament or for the Scottish Parliament, had a commitment to a referendum in it. Now, I'd like to know whether or not that's going to appear in the SNP's manifesto tomorrow. We are going to keep our promise on a vow for more powers to the Scottish Parliament.
I think Stuart Hosey answered that question. He said it wouldn't appear in their manifesto tomorrow.
No, he didn't say that. I listened very carefully.
We haven't even got through the Westminster election, and we've been incredibly clear. We are not seeking a mandate for independence at this election.
Stuart Hosey couldn't have been clearer. And so once again, we find Kezia's awareness of the actual truth of the matter is entirely at odds with reality. But no matter, she got away with it. Again. She got by with a little help from her friends in the BBC and the corporate press, who once again swept it all under the carpet and made no more of her abject nonsense. Oh, baby,
Who do you think should lead the British Labour Party?
Well, I haven't made my mind up about that yet. I've been speaking to Yvette Cooper on Friday. She came to Scotland. I also spoke to Liz Kendall by phone on Friday. I'm going to speak to Andy Burnham next week. They'll get my vote based on what they're going to do to help Scotland, what's in the best interests of Scotland, and the relationship that the UK party has with the Scottish Labour Party. I favour a much more autonomous Scottish Labour Party. I'd like to see us set our own policy here, but I don't support an independent party. I think that's wrong. The argument that we made in September during the referendum
viewers who aren't au fait with the detailed inner workings of the Labour Party, what is the difference between an independent Scottish Labour Party and a more autonomous one?
Okay, so last weekend I talked about making a positive case for Europe. I think we should vote yes. I think it's in Scotland's interest. I also argued when I said that the EU nationals should have a vote. I think if you're French or Spanish and you live in the great city of Edinburgh, like so many people do, that you should have a vote over your country's future. And I said that very publicly. Now, that was a different position from what the UK Labour Party argued, and I'd like to see us on more regular occasions have a slightly different, a more nuanced position on the issues in Scotland, standing up for Scotland's interest.
Right,
we can do that with greater party autonomy. That doesn't mean that we're an independent party. That would mean completely separating ourselves off from our UK colleagues, and I don't want to do that. I don't think that's right, especially if you follow the logic of the referendum, which is that we pool and share the resources.
What Kezia professes to want is, if we're being generous, naive to the point of stupidity. And if we're being even less generous, a deliberate attempted deception of the people of Scotland. And here's why. Labour cannot be two parties. It can either be independent and set its own policies here in Scotland, or it can be part of the UK Labour Party, in which it has to do whatever the UK Labour Party tells it to. That's not just our opinion. It's not even just a matter of fact of party hierarchy and structure, although it is that too. It's the actual law. A Scottish Labour politician legally must stand for election on the UK Labour manifesto. The example of greater autonomy for the Scottish branch office Kezia chose was the electoral franchise for the coming EU referendum. But the EU referendum is a UK issue. It's a reserved matter. Plainly, you can't have a UK referendum where the franchise is different in Scotland to the rest of the country. So what would Scottish Labour's autonomous policy mean in practice? Nothing. Every single Scottish Labour MSP and a single Scottish Labour MP could say they wanted EU citizens resident in Scotland to have the vote, but even if Labour were to be in power at both Westminster and Holyrood, it couldn't happen because UK Labour policy must by law trump Scottish Labour policy if the two are in conflict. There is and there can be only one Labour Party. If Kezia Dugdale or anyone else in the Scottish branch wants to set their own policy on a UK issue in contradiction of what the UK leader wants, they simply can't. It's as stark, as simple, as black and white as that. UK Labour could of course decide to let the Scottish regional office have the final say on devolved policy, but it's been telling us stridently for years now that that's already the case, so it wouldn't be greater anything. To pretend that Scottish Labour can ever be autonomous without being independent, and what that means in practical terms as being independent of UK Labour finances, i.e. bankrupt, is simply a lie. But it is a lie that you never find the BBC or the corporate press in Scotland seriously challenging or questioning. It seems you just accept what Kezia says, and so Kezia gets away with it once more. She gets by with a little help from her friends in the BBC and the corporate press, who simply will not confront Dugdale with serious questions over an issue that amounts to nothing more than lying to the people of Scotland.
I'm astonished that you've spent 10 minutes in this interview talking about independence and Trident when almost 50% of the poorest kids in the country can't read. I'm sure that you'd be shocked to know that 50% of the poorest kids leave our schools unable to read.
We suspect Brewer would be shocked too, because it's total cobblers. One in five of the poorest children in Scotland leave primary school unable to read well. So if only 20% of the poorest children are leaving primary school with partial reading difficulties, it seems somewhat unlikely that 50% have become completely illiterate by the time they leave school altogether. In fact, according to the official statistics, even by primary four, almost three quarters of pupils from the most deprived areas are reading well or very well. By the time they leave primary education 3 years later, it's 80%. With teachers for parents, you'd be forgiven for thinking that Kezia could tell the difference between 1 in 5, that's 20%, and a half, which is 50%. Then again, she also said in the same interview that 1 in 100 adults in the UK voted for Jeremy Corbyn. Well, if that's true, that would mean there were only 25 million adults in the UK, when in fact the electorate is over 45 million. But Kezia's statements here are nothing but complete misinformation, disingenuous untruths that you will never find the BBC or the corporate press in Scotland seriously scrutinising. It seems the corporate media in Scotland, including the BBC, just accept what Kezia says. If Kezia says it, then it must be true. And so, by such anti-journalistic means, Kezia gets away with it once more. She gets by with a little help from her friends in the BBC and the corporate press, who simply will not confront Kezia or any other Labour politician with searching questions over an issue where her comments amount to nothing more than lying to the people of Scotland. And finally, it is probably worthwhile noting here that the blind eye the corporate media in Scotland turn to all things Labour or unionist in general, their lack of journalistic scrutiny of Labour in Scotland and their barely concealed antipathy towards the SNP has not gone unnoticed in Scotland. But we do notice. We do see the spin. We see the misinformation, the lies. And as the graph here shows, the people of Scotland are sick of it. The more lies and misinformation they tell us, the higher the SNP vote climbs. Well, with friends like these, the people of Scotland will get by just fine.